Hello, my name is Christian Bludau, and in this video I want to show you how to use Woofy and give you a tour through the functionality of the program using a simple example of a masonry wall. After opening up Woofy, you will get this screen. This is a split screen. On the top you have the you have different menus, then you have a few buttons. Over here you have a project tree where you can have multiple cases as well. And on the right, that's the corresponding content to the project tree over here. First, I want to give you a short overview over the menus here. In project, you have new project, new case, you can open, you can reopen. You can save, save as, and close. That's the typical things you can do with your file. Then there is the input. This menu I never use because it's the same as in this tree. Also run, that's run the calculation and run all calculations. I always use these two buttons. Then we have outputs. I will show you that later. There's a report, status of the last calculation, quick graph, result graphs, view film, and here some extra functionality. You can insert measured data in your result graphs. You can do an ASCII export and export the film. Then over here we have the options. In unit system, you can switch the units. Standard is SI. You also could switch that to IP units, and you can set the heat transfer as you like it. It can be handled as a coefficient or as a resistance. If you check this box over here, use as default, the values will stored and remain for your next use of Woofy. Then over here, there's a button warnings. You can switch on and off some warnings. I always leave them as they are. Then we have the result data. That's interesting for your file size. If after the calculation, depending on your cases, the file size can be quite large. If you want to send your file to somebody, you can uncheck these two boxes, the courses and the film data. If you uncheck both and save as a new file, you will have a really small file which only contains your setup and only has a few kilobytes. But you cannot evaluate the results. You have to calculate again to get the results. The courses and profiles, that's what shown, I will show you that later, that's shown over here as quick graphs, and the film data, I also will show you that later. The film data contains for every hour of your calculation values which you can see in the animation and is also used for the assessment with Woofy Graph. Further, we have in the options the export format. You can set what you want as a header for the and as your file type for the ASCII export. The ASCII export was over here in the outputs. I will show you that after the calculation because at the moment there are no values in there. In the options menu, you also can change the language over here. Woofy offers a lot of different languages. After changing the language, you will have to restart Woofy. Then the new language is set. Next menu is the database. We have a database with materials. That's this one. Over here, there's a search field where you can search in the database. The black ones are included with Woofy or delivered with Woofy, and the user defined, there you can store your own TL data. Later on, I will show you how to work with the database. Next is the constructions database. Over here, constructions included, which you can use for your as basis for your assembly, for example. That would be a green roof solution, or we have floor slabs and so on. You can insert them as your construction later, or you can attach that to your construction. Last menu is the help menu. Woofy has a really good online or program help. You can press the F1 key on the position you need some help, and you will get a couple of information about that. Okay, that was the menu bar. Now let's go to the symbols over here. The first one is new project. With that you can start an empty project. Next one is open project. Then we have save project. We have a new case that will add a new case to this tree. With this one, it's grayed out at the moment because you cannot remove the first case. You can remove a case, the selected case. With that, you can calculate the actual case, and with the double hourglasses, you can calculate all cases in this tree. This is calculation with film, but that's quite not that fast, so I never used that. Over here you will get a kind of report, or it's more an overview over the last things you entered and the results you get. This one is the status of the last calculation. I will show you that after the calculation. Over here you can open up like some graphs. That's the old module to work with the results. The new one is Woofy Graph. With that you can examine every position you wish in your calculation. And that is the film. This will show you a profile for every hour of your calculation as a moving view. I will show you that after the calculation. This is again some help for the buttons. And over here, there are some post-process modules installed. The first is the U-value tool or thermal transmission tool. That's always there, that comes with Woofy. The other two you can download for free on our homepage and install them, and then you can also use them. That's Woofy Bio, that's for the mold prediction, and Woofy VTT, that's also for the mold prediction. Now let us start over and enter our first construction. I always go down this tree, and when I'm at the bottom, the construction is ready to calculate. I do not use this input menu. Let us now enter our first project. I always do that by starting on the project and go down this tree. After I'm at the bottom, the project is ready to calculate. So first enter the project name. We will use program tour as we do at the moment. You can fill in the other data as wanted. Then the next is the component. We start with the assembly. Over here is the window where you have to enter your construction. On the left is the exterior side, and on the right is the interior side. That's important for the climate later. And in between, we will set up our multi-layered masonry. For that, we can use new layer over here. With new layer, you can insert some new layers. Then we click on the first layer. We can do a double click or use this button. Assign from material database. Here's the position you also could use a sample case to start, but we will use some material from the database. Our first material will be a solid brick masonry. This one from the Fraunhofer source. And for each material, there is like a material information. And this brick masonry is a little special because it is including the mortar joints. So here a material, here not the material itself was used, was measured. Here the a complete section of the wall of the bricks and the mortar joints was measured. That's the only material of this kind in our database. We will press assign to assign that and then adapt the thickness as needed. We want to use 12 centimeters. If I do now a double click on that, I will get the material data of the layer. You can see the different values, that's the basic values and the functions. And the values are, for example, the thermal conductivity and the water vapor diffusion resistance, that's adapted to the thickness we enter. Okay, let's go to our next layer. Our next layer shall be an insulation layer. So we again click on material database and search for EPS. And we will use this simple EPS over here with a density of 15 kilogram per cubic meter. The thickness you could select over here, we will use 6 centimeters, or you can later adapt that on the top over here. And now you can see there's a grid occurring that is only shown if all thicknesses are assigned for the materials. If I add a new layer now, you can see there's no grid for this layer. We want to use a new material, and that's a lime silica brick. Lime silica brick, again from the Fraunhofer source. This one, I assigned that, and I want to use that with a thickness of 20 centimeters. Again, the grid, the calculation grid, is adapting to our new construction. Okay, one last new layer. That shall be a interior blaster. We will use a gypsum blaster. You can use the mouse wheel to scroll up and down here, or you can also enter the complete name, gypsum blaster. I won't again use that from the Fraunhofer database. That would be that one, interior blaster, gypsum blaster. Assign. So now our construction is set up. There are a few more possibilities over here I want to show you quite fast. First is the monitor positions. For you have this calculation grid over here, and during the calculation for each time step and each grid element, a value of the relative humidity and moisture is calculated. And if you want to have a look on a special position, maybe let's use this position at the connection between the lime silica brick and the EPS. Then we can place a monitor position by clicking in this magnification of this area. You can see this is the this is the complete grid, and over here is a magnification of the grid for the material you have selected at the moment. So I click over here, then a monitor position occurs over here. If I click again on that, it disappears. And yeah, we can do the same for the solid brick masonry, just for fun over here. And now we have two additional monitor positions. The monitor positions at the exterior side and the interior side, they are always there. So you do not have to care about them. You will get a result for them after the calculation. What you also can do over here is to place a source. The sources can be placed by clicking over here or on sources and sinks. You have to, again, you have to first select your material and then click your sources and sinks, and you can enter this three different sources over here. I will show you on an example, maybe the moisture source over here. That's, for example, the fraction of rain load. The source has to be entered at the position the water will occur. In this case, one element usually is too less because the pore space of one element won't be usually enough to take up the rain. So you should select that a little bit thicker for a rain source, maybe 0.5 to 1 centimeter, and you can enter the start depth in the layer. It's defined on the left side of the layer, that's 0, and the end is over here. In this case, it's 12. So if you want a source over here, just for an example, then I can enter that by setting a start depth of 11 and the end depth of 12. That would be a fraction of 1%. I only insert that to show you how to use it. I will delete it afterwards. Okay, so here's the source. Okay, and the source is shown over here. So this row, that's the heat sources, and this row, that's the moisture sources. Okay, let's delete it because we do not want to calculate with it. For that, I select it over here and just click delete. And after answering this question, if I really want to delete it, it's away. By the way, Woofy does not have a undo function, so it's a good idea to save from time to time. I will do that now by just clicking on save project file. Then I will go to the position I want to save it and give it a name. Wall program tour. And now it is saved. Okay, there are some more buttons over here. You can, with this button, we have seen that you can add a new layer. Over here you can duplicate a material. I will show you that. EPS duplicate. Now you have two of them, and you can use your mouse, click the left button, and move the material to another position. And with delete, you can delete over the material. Another not that comfortable method to enter your construction is edit the assembly by a table. You also can enter that as a table, and yeah, also here you can add a new layer, delete the layer, but that's not that comfortable as just clicking around. So let's go back to edit assembly as graph. That's this view. Below your assembly, you get some information about the total thickness, the total thermal performance, the R value and the U value. So now we have finished the assembly and the monitor positions, and we will step to the next point in our tree, that's the orientation. In the orientation dialog, you can define the orientation and inclination of your component as well as the driving rein coefficients. For the orientation, for wall, there are two important orientations. One is the north, because there's the lowest gain of solar radiation, and the other one is the main direction of driving rain. I will show you that in the climate later, where you can see which is this orientation. In Europe, that's usually the west orientation with the most driving rain. Then the inclination, that's 90 for wall, and if you have a roof, you can change that to something else. The rain load is the amount of rain multiplied with R1 plus R2 multiplied with the wind velocity. So R2, that's a factor on the wind, and R1, that is zero for vertical components. And if I change that, for example, over here, you can see the factor for the wind is getting zero. So the influence of the wind is away, and R1 is getting is becoming one. So all the rain, according to this formula, is coming on the surface. The reason is you have a horizontal surface, all the rain, also that one which is splashing back or driven by rain, will on some position come on your surface. So let's switch that back to 90 degrees for our wall. And over here you also could set up the height of the building. That influences the wind, or the factor for the wind velocity. There's also a second rain load model available from the ASHRAE standard 160p. There the rain load is a little bit calculated in a different way, and there is no factor for the inclination. So it's not that good to use for a roof situation. Okay, for our example, we will set the orientation to west. The inclination is on 90 degrees for a wall, and the height of the building, we will calculate a short building. Again, I click on save, accept the overwriting of my project file, and then I'm finished with orientation and I can go to the surface transfer coefficients. By the way, over here the green and the red hooks unfortunately does not mean that you have entered everything correct. It only shows that you have visited this positions. It's getting green immediately if you go on that. Okay, over here you can set the heat transfer coefficients. For example, that's the external wall. There are some other you can choose for a roof, for example, for according to the German standard for 108 and so on. We will stay with the external wall. There's also the possibility to calculate that wind dependent. We recommend to do that on very windy, maybe coastal locations of your building, but usually the constant heat transfer is okay. The information of the long wave radiation parts that is needed for the explicit radiation balance. I will show you a little bit later. So that's the exterior surface. We have a heat transfer coefficient. We have a if you have a resistance over here, remember you can change that in options unit system. Then the SD value, that's thought to used for coatings or such things. We recommend to use that also for roofing felts and tight materials on the outside. For example, we have a metal foil over here and a bituminous felt. But please keep in mind, if you use that, do not build in the layer into your construction, otherwise you have the layer double. And this setting has no effect on the rain, as an SD value is only in affecting the diffusion. So if you want to calculate like a rain situation on the surface, like we want to do at the moment, you should not use the SD value over here. Next one is the short wave radiation absorptivity and the long wave radiation emissivity. Here's a whole list you can select. We have a red wall at the moment. Remember, we have this solid brick masonry. So let us select the red bricks over here. Long wave is not showing a value at the moment because this is only calculated if you use the explicit radiation balance. We mainly recommend to use that for roofs and situations where you want to get information about the dew water, for example. In our case, we do not have to use that. We do not have to use that. For roof, you also could set reduction factors caused by shading. That's only that's grayed out at the moment. If you select for the heat transfer coefficient, if you select roof, you can choose a shading situation over here. But we are at the wall at the moment. We will also calculate without the explicit radiation balance. You can compare the influence. For massive buildings, it's not, the influence is not that high. For lightweight constructions, it will make a big difference. With the ground short wave reflectivity, that's the reflectivity of the of the ground your component is looking at. So if you have a grass or a lawn surface, you will get a complete, or you will get another reflection from the ground than if you have maybe like a paved parking lot. You could change that here. There are some examples, but I would recommend just to leave that at the standard value as long as you do not have certain values for that. Then with the adhering fraction of rain, that switches on and off the rain absorption of your surface. So if you set that to no absorption, no rain from the driving rain will come to your surface. If you set that to depending on the inclination of the component, then for a wall you can see that's 0.7. Reason for that is that 100% of the driving rain are coming on your surface, 30% is splashing away, and 70% stay there for suction. The amount which will come here of the driving rain, that's that what is calculated over here with the rain load. That's the rain load, and if the rain load is adapted, you can set over here. Then we come to the interior surface, the right side. Here's the heat transfer coefficient. This one is coupled to the external wall. You can change, if you want to change that, you have to select, for example, user defined over here. Then you can enter a new value here and also here. We will stay at external wall and 8 watt per square meter and Kelvin at the inside. And again, here there's a SD value which you can use for coatings or tiles, something like that. But remember, if you build it, if you use it here, do not build it into your construction. Okay, that was the surface transfer coefficients. We again click on save and accept the overwriting of our file, and then we go to the initial conditions. The initial conditions can be set constant across the component in each layer, or you can read them from a file. More important than the temperature is the relative humidity, as the temperature adapts quite fast to your construction, while the humidity may take a long time depending on the tightness of your assembly. And for example, if you use constant across the component, 80%, that's the equilibrium moisture if you store a material in the ambient air. And depending on the initial humidity, the water content is calculated. You can see if I change that, you will get different values over here. How is Woofy doing that? For each material, there is a moisture storage function which defines at which pore air moisture the material has which water content. So you can see here over at 0.8, we will have a value of 18, and that's exactly what is in here when we are setting this 80%. And the 80%, as I told you, is the equilibrium moisture if you store the material outside. It's a good moisture usually to start for a construction, because if the construction is drying out, you can see that quite fast. So if your construction is accumulating or taking up water, you also can see that quite good. There's another possibility in each layer. For that, you could also assign the typical built-in moisture. Have a look on this water contents. If I press this button, assign typical built-in moistures, you can see the solid brick masonry. That's because of the water which is spilled off and so on, is getting quite wet, as well as the lime silica brick and the blaster. They all have high values, and the EPS, that does not have any built-in moisture, so there's no change in that. You also could just switch back to constant across component to reset it. If you want to see how fast, for example, one layer can dry out, you could just assign within each layer, this single layer, special water content, maybe 200, and then Woofy will start over calculate with these values. In our example, we just will use constant across the component. That was the settings for the initial conditions. I again save and accept that. And then we step on the control. Here in the control, the first point is the calculation period. Over here we set how long we want to calculate and the start of our calculation. The breeze election is start at the 1st of October. Reason is if you have built-in moisture after November, December, if it's getting cold outside, the construction will be stressed by the water which is coming from the room going into your construction and tries to go to the cold side, to the outside. So let us set that to 5 years. We have now 5 years, and yeah, that's all. You also could define here some profiles for which you can export the data after the calculation, but in the most cases you will not need to do that. Also the time step you could adapt, but that mainly makes sense if you have measured data maybe in another period than 1 hour, often smaller, a few minutes and so on. Then let's go to the numerics. That are all special settings, more for investigation of special cases. We can switch off the heat transport calculation. We can switch off the moisture transport calculation. That if is needed, if you want to see the influence of one of these transport methods. If you switch off the moisture transport calculation, the moisture is kept at the settings you entered for the initial conditions, and just the heat is calculated. All the materials are set to the initial moisture from the initial conditions. Then here again are some special options you usually do not need to touch. You could exclude capillary conduction, latent heat, and so on. Then also the numerical parameters you usually do not have to touch. That's increased accuracy and adapted convergence. That's coming from times where the computers was much slower, and so nowadays we do not have to change that. The adaptive time step control, that's useful if you have problems with your convergence, so you do not get a good result, then you can enable that. What is that doing is it's dividing one time step into three steps and calculating them each other, and that often is enough to get a better convergence in the calculation. Then we have here the settings for the geometry. We are usually calculating with a Cartesian system. You could change to a radially symmetric system. In this case, you can define a symmetry axis, which is on the left of your construction. So if you enter a value over here, the construction you set up is rotated and is calculated like it is a piece of cake. That can be used if you want to calculate maybe pipe insulation or something like that. You will not see a big difference in the calculation or in the result output, but the volumes you are calculating are calculated in a different way. They are not calculated as cubic anymore, they are more calculated as like a piece of cake. Okay, again, we switch that back to Cartesian, and then we save. The adaptive time step control I just leave on for the moment. And then we go to the climate, and over here you can assign a climate. Please be careful over here for the outdoor side. Usually we set a climate from the map file. You also could set one of the others, but in our case it makes no sense. That one which you select over here, that is the one which is set for your calculation. So at the moment, for the outdoor, we want to set from map file. I click on set climate, and over here, like a globe opens up. It's no map, it's a globe. You can use your mouse wheel to zoom in and zoom out. And we will use Holzkirchen. There's also the possibility to use user-defined files. You can see I have in my program I already inserted a whole list of locations, and if the you can add them over here with add if you have some third-party climate files, and if you hook this box show on map over here, then the files are shown as red dots in your map. Okay, I want to use Holzkirchen and just press OK. Then I get the causes of the temperature and relative humidity and some more information about the file. I can have a look on all the parameters over here. For example, global radiation, diffuse radiation, normal rain, and so on. And also here on the right side, I get some info about the climate file, some information that's here location, position, altitude, time zone, number of data lines. Please keep in mind, in WUFI, 1 year is always 8,760 hours. So if you want to make your own or enter your own climate files, you have to delete the leap year. So the 29th of February. Over here we have some information about the climate elements. Temperature is included, relative humidity is included, that's the radiation, long wave radiation, wind, rain, cloud index is not included, but we do not need that if we have the shortwave radiation, and the air pressure is defined in this climate file. And over here we also have the possibility for a climate analysis. If you press this, it will calculate for a moment, and then it shows you some data about your climate file, mean temperature over here 6.6 degrees, min max temperature, some of the counter radiation, cloud index is not included, and as well as the mean relative humidity and the mean wind speed and the normal rain sum. I told you before in the orientation dialog which is the I want to show you which is the main driving rain direction. You can see that over here, that's the driving rain sum plotted over the direction. So in Holzkirchen, the main direction is the west and maybe this west-southwest. On the left, that's the solar radiation sum. Imagine that's like a salad bowl. On the top you have the horizontal surface, and over here it's inclining to the north, and here it's inclining to the south. So if we press or if we have a look on that and just do not move the mouse, you can see in the middle, so on a horizontal surface, we have a value of 1200 kilowatt hours per square meter in year, while in the north the solar radiation sum is only 400 kilowatt hours per square meter and year, and the highest amount you will get about 30 degree to the south, in Europe to the south it's about 1400 kilowatt hours per square meter and year. That's the reason why the solar panels are most, if possible, they have an inclination about 30 degrees to the south. Okay, now we set for the outdoor, for the left side, we set for map file. Now we click on the indoor, and here we can select a model which is deriving the indoor conditions from the outdoor temperature, for example, that would be EN15026. Another possibility would be the model from ISO 13788. That's the Euroglacier standard, but that is kind of extreme values. Then we have the US standard ASHRAE 160. There we have also some settings for the air conditioning and number of bedrooms, air exchange, so if you have a kind of ventilation. And the last possibility over here are the sine curves. You can also set them user-defined if you like. That is useful for unheated rooms like basements and so on. We will go to the EN15026 DIN 4108 model. Here the indoor temperature is derived from the outdoor air temperature. You can see from from minus 20 to 10 degree, we have 20 degrees indoor, and from 20 and higher, we have 25 degrees inside. The relative humidity over here, that's the setting according to the German standard DIN 4108. That's that's medium moisture load plus 5% for design. Here is the relative humidity gain from the outdoor air temperature between 35% and 65%, and you will get this green curve. The medium moisture load can be used for normal living situations, including bath and kitchen, as long as you have a typical occupancy. Okay, that was our indoor climate. Now we are finished with all our settings and we can calculate our case. Before I want to do that, I press on save again, save that, and now I click on the hourglass over here and it starts calculating. So now it's close to finish, and after it finished you will get this table status of the last calculation. I closed it for a second. That's the same table which you can open if you click that button over here. And here you will get some information about your calculation. That's the calculation duration, begin and end of calculation, number of convergence failures, and balances. These are quite important because the balances should not be much different. If you have high differences over here, you should recheck your construction. Then on the bottom, we also have information about the sources. If we would have entered a source, we would get the source strength over here. All these values as well as the balance you have to divide by the calculation time, because that's the value over the complete calculation time. So after the calculation you get over here a new point, that's the quick graph. If I go on that, you can see the total water content over here. The construction takes up some water in the first year up to here, and then it's drying out, but in a kind of equilibrium state. The high peaks, they are related to the rain events, and as we use 1 year for the calculation, the results are repeating periodically each year. So that's the first year, second year, third year, fourth year, and fifth year. Then we get information about the water content in the single layers. We have over here the solid brick masonry, then the EPS, you can see here's only a small change in the water content, while in the solid brick masonry we have a difference from maybe about 60 to over 180 kilogram per cubic meter, while for the EPS we only have 2 to 6. Then the lime silica brick, that's drying out, and you have again a change, but that is more like the interior plaster that changes close to the, or in accordance to the interior climate. Then we over here have information about the monitor positions we set. The exterior surface, there's a high change of the relative humidity and the temperature. That is the first position we set, so in this solid brick masonry close to the EPS, and you over here we get a high level of relative humidity. It's about 98% up to this position. To remember, where was this position? That's over here. So we have a high moisture content here over here because of the rain, and the temperatures at the same time, go down to minus 10 degrees. So if we have over here, if we do not have a frost safe material, we can get frost problems. Then in the lime silica brick, that's on the other side. So that's this monitor position. Here the course is related to the indoor conditions. During the summertime, we have relative humidities up to maybe 75%. And temperatures up to 26 degrees, while in the winter time we get quite low relative humidities over here. That's 45%, something like that, and temperatures about 15 degrees. And the last one is that at the interior surface, over here we have the lowest temperatures of 18 degrees and the highest of 25. The 18 degrees are because of the insulation with 6 centimeters is not quite well. And again, the relative humidity is close to the conditions indoors. So that can be used to get a quick overview over your results. Also shown over here are the isobaths. That's a display of the, or graph of the relative humidity over the temperature, and that can be used to evaluate the mold situation. Let's go to the interior surface. You can see we have temperatures between 17 to 25 degrees over here, and we have relative humidities between 39 to 70. What is also shown here, that's the lowest isobath of mold. If you have situations that the points, the single hours, go over this line, you can check that with Woofy Bio, for example, to see if you have a possibility that the molds can grow. But if the conditions are always below this lowest isobath, there's no problem with mold. Let's go to the monitor position, which is at the inside of the EPS. That's this one, lime silica brick. And by the way, the color, this is for every calculated hour, this is one point. And as this graph do not have any time relation, we gave it a color. So yellow is the start of your the calculation and black is the end of the calculation. So I can see it is moving a little bit to the right. Over here, the isoplane or the limb curves are not shown because the model of WoofyBio is only validated for the interior surface, but they, if you compare it with over here, they're going from 100% at 0 degree to 80% at 30 degrees. So if I go back, they would be somewhere over here. And again, there is no risk for mold. By the way, I again save my construction. Now the results are included. That needs a little bit longer time. And then let's have a look on the film. This is the animation 1D. At the moment, we see the initial conditions. So our complete construction is at 20 degree and at 80% RH. And over here, you also can see the corresponding water content in the layer. On the left side, we have outside. On the right side, we have the inside conditions. So this arrows, the red one is the outside temperature and the outside relative humidity, the green one, and same for inside. So now we can press play over here and it starts moving. And you can see each time you get like a rain event over here. At the moment there's no rain, that's only high relative humidities, but the water content is rising up over here. Maybe I press pause at the moment. You can see the indoor temperature is quite constant through the lime silica brick up to the insulation. Then here, for example, for the cold times, we get a temperature gradient. And then again, outside in the masonry, the temperature is also quite constant. If you get relative humidities up to 100% on a position, that means that there is a dew water falling out at this position in the material. The arrows over there, that's the heat fluxes. That are the moisture fluxes, diffusion, and in the middle it can also be, not for EPS, but it could also be not only diffusion, but capillary fluxes. Okay, let's speed that up a little bit to come to the rainy seasons. Ah, over here that's the sun, the energy of the sun, and now we can see at times when it's raining, you get a column over here, and this is sucked in quite fast because we have the solid brick masonry is a highly sucking brick. So let's speed it up a little bit. All in all, we have a quite high relative humidity in the solid brick masonry. That was the same we have seen in the monitor positions before. We had a look on this position. So together with the temperature going down to about minus 10 degree, we can get frost problems if our material is not frost safe over here. So at the inside of the solid brick masonry. Also at the outside, we have similar conditions. I stop the film view. If I want to have a look on the courses in each calculation grid element, for that I click on over here, create course, and then maybe have a look on this one. it's the same, we had the monitor position, and we get about the same values like our monitor before. We have the temperature over here, we have the relative humidity and the corresponding water content. The solid line, that's the water content in the whole layer, while the thin line, that's the water content in this one calculation grid. There's also the possibility to build like a mean course for this. So for that I press this button over here and mean up to end of film. Then it's calculating for a moment. And it's showing you the mean profile over your 5 years in this case. Okay, from animation 1D you also can examine positions in the calculation grid in Woofy Bio. Remember over here we only get the limb curves for the interior surface. The same is if you press on this Woofy Bio button, then you only get the situations at the interior surface, but at the interior surface there are no mold situation. We want to have a look on this monitor position if there is some if there will be some mold risk. So we go to the film, press the Woofy Bio button over here and then select this grid element, which is the closest one to the EPS. Then Woofy Bio is opening up. That will need a second. It's opening up over here. So, and that's Woofy Bio. Case one, it got the position, or it got the information from the movie file. Over here we have some input data. The most important is the occupant exposition class. Here you can select if the position has contact to the user or not. In our case, we have a surface inside of the construction without direct contact to the indoor air. Then the initial RH you have not to touch. Then the substrate classes. Class 0 is the optimum substrate, that's not really occurring in building situations. Then class 1 is that's like a good substrate for organic materials like wood or paper or something like that. Then class 2 are the mineral surfaces. Is no optimum substrate, and class K, that are the classes which are harm to humans. We will stay with class 2. Over here, that's the moisture storage function of the spore. And the climate, so next point, that is the climate we got from the monitor position or from the position in our construction, which we sent to Woofy Bio. And then the results, you can see there is over here, there's no risk of mold growth. You have like a traffic light, and this diagram is showing the critical water content and the water content of the spore. And if the water content of the spore is higher than the critical, or is rising above the critical water content, then the spore can grow and you will get like a mold growth over here. Maybe let's search for a position in the construction where we have a higher amount of moisture. I will minimize that, then click again on Woofy Bio, and now I select our second monitor position, which is in the solid brick masonry, because we have a really high amount of moisture there. Remember, it was about 98% all the time. So input again, surface inside construction without direct contact to the indoor air. Then this is the climate with a high relative humidity. And then over here, the results, and you can see the mold risk is growing, and the traffic light, which is red, and that's it's only red for this first year. With this slider, you can select the time period of 1 year which you want to assess. Over here we would have mold growth situations, but for mold growth we also need like a air gap, like moving air and so on, that are things which are not going into the model. So there is the possibility of mold, but if it is also depends also on the building situation. There's a second possibility of evaluating, that's the mold index. The mold index of Viitanen always have a look on 1 year, so you can only assess the last point over here. And this is a quite simple system. I open up the help for that. The mold index has 6 steps or 7 steps. 0 is no growth, then 1 is some growth visible under the microscope, and with 3, some growth detected visually, so you can see it, thin hyphae found under the microscope, and with 4, visual coverage more than 10%. So with 3 to 4, the user can see the mold, and everything you can see is bad, so the mold growth should stay at least below 3. Okay, I will close that. Another post-process module is over here, the thermal transmission post-process module. If you click on that, you will get a transient thermal transmission or a transient R-value of your construction, including the water content. So you can see over here, at times you have high water contents in your over your construction, the thermal transmission is higher than where you have low water contents. The months between, so there's a monthly mean value, the months between May and October are not shown, because over here there's the possibility that the U value gets negative because of the solar radiation, which is also included in the calculation. You could switch that on in the options menu. The traffic light, this one is according to the to old German standards. So if they are, so they are based on the minimum thermal transmission which is needed for hygienic reasons. Then we also have over here the black line, that's the dry value. So if all materials would be dry, you would have this thermal transmission. If you are at U80, so that's also our initial conditions, then you would have this thermal transmission at 0.48. And the mean value of this shown course, that's the red line. With the typical built-in moisture, you remember when I have clicked that in the initial conditions, then we would have the green line and the transient results for each month, that are the blue dots. If you open up a second case, you can compare them over here in all cases. For that, you minimize this window, go on another case, and again press the thermal transmission tool button. Okay, then I also told you I will show you the ASCII export. Over here you can do an ASCII export of your of the different values, for example total water content, contents and layer and so on. I click some, that's the temperature, a relative humidity at your monitor positions. Over here are the heat flux, moisture flux, air pressure, relative humidity, rain, solar radiation. Some of these values may be grayed out because we are not allowed to give out the data for all the climate files, but for the Holzkirchen file it's allowed to export. Okay, and if I select some of the values and then I define an output file, ASCII export, and press OK. This is exported. And I will open up the file for you over here. That's the project file. You can see that's at 55 megabytes now with the calculated results for 5 years. And that's the ASCII export. And if I open that up, with Notepad, for example, then you can see you get here one column for date time, the air pressure, heat flux, then the moisture diffusion flux and total water content. That's that what I have selected for output. Then another important tool for evaluation is the WUFI graph over here. And that one opens up with the same results like we had in the quick graph. By the way, WUFI graph also has its own online help. If you press F1, you will get a quite good help on that. So over here you get the quick graphs, and in this user defined area you can create your own courses. Just do a right click, you can for example temperature, then a selection window opens up. Over here you have to select the area where you want the temperature. If you select more than one calculation grid element, you will get a mean value for that. Let's maybe for example, we want to know the temperature over here for this 3 grid elements. It's also showing you that the selection has a width of 12.54 millimeters. And then I can give that a name, series name, temperature masonry close to EPS. Okay. And now I get the course over here. And now I can, over here I have a page. It's also like a tree view. On the page I have one diagram at the moment, and in the diagram I have one course at the moment. If I want a new course in this diagram, then I click on the diagram, add a series. I can add a temperature series. If I add a series with another unit, I will get a second axis over there. So let's use a relative humidity at the same position. The position is still selected. So I just can give that a new name, RH, masonry close to EPS, and then okay. Over here I also could adapt like an average, time average or moving time average, and if I select that I can enter the window size for the average. So in this case 730, that would be 1 month, 730 hours. Well, I just leave that. Okay. So that's our, this looks like funny because that's a that was the average and not the flowing average. You can change that by selecting the course, right mouse click and options. And then I take the moving time average and that looks much nicer. Okay, let's do a second picture on this page for the water content of something. For that, I click on page, right mouse click, water content, maybe in kilogram per cubic meter. And now, as there are still my selection, I click, do a right click, deselect all, and then I want the water content, for example, of my EPS. So I just do a right click over here on my EPS and select material. Then the complete material is selected. And I can name that, for example, EPS. On the blue bar, I could change the color. I do not have to do that now. And press OK. And I now get a second diagram with my water content for the EPS. There's some other possibilities. You can do like a right click on the diagram chart settings. And over here you can edit the axis. Let's edit the Y axis. We switch off auto scale. And then we want to start at maybe an even value, minus 15 to 40 in dy and 5. I press apply and you can see now I have an even scaling over here. What I also can do is, I will show you in the other diagram over here, chart settings, series, and then I click on series 1. Here I could change again my color, my line thickness, my line type and my line thickness. Maybe let's make it thicker, 3, apply. Now we have a thick line. And over here I can add some reference values. A reference value is just a horizontal line in my diagram. It's good for limits or something like that. To show you, I insert a reference value over here at maybe 5 kilogram per cubic meter. This is always connected to a series. So over here, if I would select the second series, I can add that on the relative humidity axis. But we are now in the diagram below. I pressed add, I give it a name, example ref, and that's at a value of 5. And I give it a red color, and I want a dotted line, and a little bit thicker, maybe 5. Oh no, 50 is a little bit too much. 5. Okay. Now I have a reference line in here, which is also shown in the legend. Okay. If you want to have a new page, you press a right button in the empty area over here, right button. Let's do the isopleth, just to show you that you can also do that in Woofy Graph. I again select this monitor position. Oh, select the different materials first, right mouse click, deselect all, and then I select the same grid element like the monitor position and press on OK. That was the one we had a look on in Woofy Bio before. And here are the limb curves. And if you do a right click, export, you have different possibilities. You can always export as ASCII file or as a picture. And in this special case, if you have an isobleth diagram, you also can export it directly to the installed post-process modules. I again select Woofy Bio, open that up. That needs a second. Here it's coming. And you can see we have the same like before. It's a little bit different because we did not select that and the class. So now it's the same. Now it's the same like before. Okay. There are many more possibilities. Maybe have a look on the user-defined diagrams. You can also can display profiles. Over here, profile along cross-section and so on. And in the file options, you also can check if you want to Woofy to remember the grid position you have selected or not. In the most cases, this is quite useful. Then there are some definitions for the export formats and the display in general. You can also save that file, save project. And give it some name, wall assembly, save. Okay, and then you can reopen that later. So that was the main functions in Woofy. There are much more functions. I guess you have to find out yourself. And remember, if you need help to at some position, just press the F1 button and you will get a quite useful help file. At the end, I want to show you how to create further cases. For that, I would recommend to first give the case a name, in this case wall 1, and you also can give some remarks. That's because if you have a project file with 20 cases and you open it up about next year or something like that, it's not easy to remember what you have done if there's only the information case 1, 2, 3 and 5. Then over here, this was that button, new case, we can generate a new case, and then there is this copy over button, and we can, if needed, first we give the case a name, wall 2, and we can copy over everything. There's nothing happening, but in background, all the data we set over here are copied down here. Now we have the same assembly, and let's imagine you want to calculate that with another insulation. You press on EPS. I go to material database and let's search for a mineral wool, just as an example. Mineral wool, this one, assign, and it's asking you if you want to keep the current thickness or overwrite it. We want to keep it, so we select no, and then we have over here mineral wool instead of the EPS. Maybe we call that case 2 mineral wool and case 1 is the EPS. Okay. You also can use another thickness if you like. You can change everything you need. You can change the climate conditions and so on. But that's just to show you. And now, if we press run all, both cases would be calculated. But the first case is already calculated. So I just press on run. And then the second case is calculated. okay, again, status of the last calculation. This is not opening if you press the run all button, but you can reopen that with this symbol over there. Okay, now we have the quick graphs for that. They're a little bit different. And we also can now compare this case to the first case in our Woofy Graph project by again clicking on the Woofy Graph button. A window is opening. Do I want to use the open project, or do I want to open a new project? I want to insert that in the existing project, so I just click OK. And now I have the second case over here. And for example, let us compare in the next picture or next page, let us compare the water content of the insulation. Just as an example, I do a right click in the user defined empty area, new page, water content, and insulation materials are mostly compared in percent per volume. So I select the last one. Again, the window opens up with my selection. At the moment over here, you can see as I was in the case 2, also here my case 2 is selected. I can change that to case 1, do a right click, select material for the insulation, and the name is EPS. Okay, so that's the water content in percent per volume in the EPS. And then I do a right click on the water content picture, add a water content series again in percent per volume. And now I use the case number 2, right click on the mineral wool and select material. In this case, the Woofy cannot, or Woofy Graph cannot remember the selection because this is another assembly or another case. And I select the material. You can see it's a little bit thicker. I calculate that with 8 centimeter, while the other one was 6 centimeter, but doesn't matter. Over here, I choose another color, maybe this one. Okay. And then I press another name, mineral wool. And that above that, that's the name of the title of the diagram. That's comparison of insulation. Okay, so you see over here, that's the title, and that are the two graphs. Yeah, that was just to show you the comparison of two different cases. I hope you enjoyed the program tour, and I wish you much fun with Woofy.